webinar, Protecting Your Retirement from the Cost of Long-Term Care, sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association and Alumni Career Services. My name is Kara Tyrone, Associate Director of Alumni Career Services, and our presenters today are Corky Long and Steve Bohm with Northwestern Mutual in Manhattan. Before we start, I'd like to share a few housekeeping tips and reminders. Today's presentation is being recorded for the YouTube channel. Simply go to youtube.com and search Georgetown Alumni Career Services or click on the link in the chat area to check out over 375 videos of past sessions. There are two audio options for today's webinar. You can listen via your computer speakers or dial in to the conference number provided. Participants are not required to have a headset, but you are welcome to use one. It is important to note if you experience any audio difficulties using your speakers, this can be caused by having too many software applications open. Feel free to close these apps or simply join us via this conference line provided on the control panel and in your reminder email. Questions are welcome. Please type in the questions in the question area on your GoToWebinar control panel screen as you have them. The presenters are planning to answer as many questions as time allows during the Q&A portion of the presentation. PowerPoint slides will also be emailed to you following today's session. And finally, if you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the chat area or visit the GoToWebinar support page. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce our presenters. Corky Long, MBA class of 87, assists clients of Northwestern Mutual in planning for comprehensive financial security in all stages of life. Steve Bohm has been a long-term care specialist with Northwestern Mutual Financial since 1997. Corky and Steve, thank you for your time today, and now I'll turn it over to you.
Thanks so much, Kara. Steve and I are really grateful for the opportunity to present, especially for me, to a Georgetown audience. My time on the Hilltop was a fantastic opportunity to me, and I'm sure that all of you feel the same way. As Kara explained, I help clients with a wide variety of financial planning and helping people to establish their financial security. Privileged to be accompanied by Steve Bohm, who is the long-term care specialist for Northwestern NYC Midtown. So what are we going to talk about today? Our goal today really is simply to communicate some ideas and information that will help you to take charge of your future in the area of long-term care. Steve and I can make ourselves available to you as a resource after the presentation to discuss this information or any other information if you're interested. And our contact information is on the last page of this presentation. But really our goal is just to provide you with good information so you can begin to make some important decisions. Long-term care insurance, and how do we evaluate long-term care insurance providers? So what is long-term care? Long-term care is defined as the services provided to someone who's suffering from a chronic condition who needs assistance with the activities of daily living. Activities of daily living are such as bathing, eating, dressing, going to the bathroom, transferring, which is moving from one place to the other, or a situation where someone with cognitive problems is in need of supervision. So chronic conditions are generally progressive in nature. They generally get worse as time goes on, and there are generally not cures for chronic conditions. So long-term care, which can be provided either in the home, at an other stay at home if they need care. And I'm sure that many of you on the call have actually experienced situations where you or another family member was caring for a relative or loved one at home. Care at home can be supplemented by community care, such as adult daycare. But what usually happens is as the need for care increases, then there may be a need for an alternative living facility. For example, assisted living facilities, which are basically an apartment-like setting with some available support services. And then the most dependent people, which is usually towards the end stages of long-term care, may need care in a nursing home with 24-hour skilled care. But generally, it starts at home. So a lot of these decisions associated with long-term care, they tend to get associated with old age. But, you know, really, I think one of the most surprising things about long-term care is that 40% of all people currently receiving long-term care in the United States are under 65 years old. So people really of any age who suffer from a chronic illness like MS or other disabling conditions or cognitive impairments may all require long-term care. So it's important to think about this early in life while you're healthy so that you really have the widest range of options available to you. The takeaway here fundamentally is, though, that long-term care in all stages of life can create a heavy financial burden for people of all ages. So long-term care, and I'm sure the reason for many of you finding time to spend time on this topic today is that long-term care is in the news on a daily basis. And there are a few reasons why it's a greater issue today than even several years ago. These are longer life expectancy, changes in family demographics, and of course, cost. But it is becoming a more and more important consideration. So here's the good news. The good news is people are living longer. You know, if we look back to 1900, the average life expectancy was, you know, somewhere in the late 40s. But as this graph shows, our life expectancy has increased dramatically to the late 70s as of year 2000, and today it's about 85 years of age in the United States. So why is this? Well, it's not a secret that, you know, better health care, medical advances, improved lifestyle, all these things have contributed to our longer lifestyle. We're basically taking better care of ourselves than we did 30, 40, 50 years ago. But there's a catch to this. These medical advances have not cured old age. Just because we're living longer doesn't mean that we are living independently longer. The second major issue has to do with changing family demographics. First is dual income families. The number of dual income families continues to increase in America. So if a parent or spouse needs long-term care, we're stuck with juggling caregiving with work responsibilities, and that causes a lot of hardship for a family. What do we mean about a sandwich generation? This is a combination of a generation of people who are starting families later in life with people also living longer, which has resulted in a generation which is sandwiched by the potential to be both rearing children and caring for an aging parent. Then finally, geographic dispersion. You know, it's not a secret that we're a far more mobile society than in the past. And the impact of this is that many who are about to need long-term care, who do need long-term care, have much less of a ready social support network. So families have been and continue to be caregivers, but the change in family demographics has put a lot of pressure on this situation. Finally, perhaps the most frightening issue here is around cost. In all three primary caregiving areas, home health care, assisted living facilities, and nursing homes, the cost is really significant. So if we look, and costs do vary greatly from one geography to another within the United States. So this is an average figure. But for a full 8-hour shift for a home health aide can cost around $56,000 a year. You know, assisted living in that apartment-like setting, you know, that can be on average over $38,000. And then a private room in a nursing home, round-the-clock skilled care, that's over $91,000 a year. Then we have to look at the impact of inflation. If we inflate these numbers by 5%, compounded out annually, and look out for 30 years, the effect of inflation on the cost of care can be very dramatic. One might ask, why 5%? You know, inflation today is more like 1 to 2%. Well, a shortage of nursing skills is exacerbating the impact of inflation on healthcare. So what are the options? Where is the money coming from? That's really the question, and that's really the issue that I'm sure most of you are really focused on. What are the options? Well, people do have several options, but some are actually misconceptions. Generally, people that the potential options include family, private pay, disability insurance, Medicare or health insurance, Medicaid or long-term care insurance. So let's first talk about family care as an option. At what cost and to whom? Families have historically been primary caregivers in many situations, but the change in demographics puts pressure on that to continue to be the case. In addition, really family members as caregivers is not often a planned option, but rather a situation that is in reaction to an unexpected need. So families will jump in and help, but if you rewound the situation, both the person receiving the care and the people giving the care would often choose another option. Most would prefer that our family be there to be there for support, but not be required to be ones who are actually providing the care. So another perceived option is disability insurance. But disability income insurance could be referred to as DI insurance. This is really designed to protect your ability to earn income should you become sick or hurt, unable to work. It's not designed specifically to fund long-term care. So there are really kind of the two types of disability in this context. One type of disability only affects your income, and disability insurance will pay benefits to replace a portion of your paycheck. This is intended to cover routine living expenses. But then there's a second type of disability, one in which the disability not only impacts your ability to earn an income, but it also requires long-term care due to injury or illness. So disability income insurance does not protect or replace the additional expense required for long-term care. And you can look at this example of two different sets of monthly expenses. The first is $5,000 in hypothetical monthly daily routine living expenses that might be covered by a disability income insurance. The scenario here is someone who perhaps was earning $8,000 a month before they were disabled. But in the second type of disability where long-term care is needed, not only have they lost their income, but they also have an additional $4,500 per month in long-term care expenses. So another perceived option is Medicare. Now, the easy way to think about this is pay attention to the care portion of the word Medicare. Medicare is really designed to provide health care. For the majority of Americans, it becomes our health insurance at age 65. It's very, very similar to the health insurance that we have during our working years. It's designed to pay for acute short-term situations, broken leg, emergency surgery, other medical requirements. But Medicare and health insurance are designed for short-term events. They are not designed for long-term care situations. According to the U.S. government, Guide for Medicare says Medicare doesn't cover long-term care. There is one piece of confusion around this. In some cases, Medicare can pay for acute short-term rehabilitation in a nursing home, but as soon as the nursing home determines you're not going to recover from this condition or have a chronic condition, Medicare will stop paying. So Medicare is not designed to cover for long-term care. Medicaid. So focus on the aid portion of the word Medicaid. Medicaid is a safety net. It's a welfare program for those who are in need and don't have the means to pay for care themselves. Medicaid does pay for some degree of long-term care, and it acts as a safety net for the indigent, for the poor who cannot afford it at all. The disadvantage to this are $2,500 and assign all income in excess of $50 a month in order to qualify for Medicaid, which means that it's really not a desirable option for the majority of people who are not truly indigent. Another option is to pay privately for long-term care expenses out of your own income and savings. So let's look at this option. We're looking at 5 years of home health care at estimated annual cost of $56,000. So if we just assume that this cost increases due to inflation 5%, in 30 years, the annual cost will be $242,000. And the 5 years of care would require a total of $1.3 million. So why 5% of general inflation is only 2% today? Because healthcare costs are accelerating much quicker than general inflation. They're being inflated by a nursing shortage. So to put this in context, in order to pay that $1.3 million for future long-term care, we would either need to invest a lump sum today of about $134,000, assuming that it earns 7% every year, or we'd have to save over $10,000 a year, also earning 7% a year for the next 33 years. For most of us, to pay for this future long-term care event strictly out of our income and savings is not a realistic idea. So you can fund this care out of pocket, but it's vastly more expensive than another option, which is long-term care insurance. So there are some considerations when we think about long-term care and long-term care insurance. It's effectively tax favorable financial property. It purchases future care with discounted dollars. One fact is that we may never experience a long-term care event. So if it does happen, it may not cost as much as the examples we just went through. Those are averages, and it may not happen for as long as those examples. But there are other considerations. It may happen longer than the example, and it may cost more. The unknowns are what makes insurance a potential hedge with a balance between paying for some of the long-term care event out of your own pocket and funding some of the event with insurance. Today, long-term care insurance is far more flexible than it was 10 or 15 years ago, when it was really mainly in nursing home insurance and was somewhat restrictive in terms of qualifying for the benefits of the policy. Today's policies generally pay for the continuum of long-term care, starting in the home and in the community, then moving to alternative living facilities like assisted living centers, and finally nursing homes. These policies really can offer a lot of flexibility to how and where care is received. So here's the question. How do we become eligible for the benefits of long-term care insurance? You know, can you just walk into an assisted living facility and it starts to play? So the answer is no. There are typically two different triggers to be able to qualify for benefits. For federally tax-qualified policies, which are most common today, these triggers are established by the Internal Revenue Code. But one trigger is a need for assistance due to a physical need. So this is associated with the two of the six activities of daily living that I mentioned earlier. So these are bathing, dressing, toileting, transferring, which is moving from one place to, from a couch to a chair, for example, continence, and eating. Example would be somebody who had an accident, confined to a wheelchair. They may need somebody to pull them up out of bed, bathe them, and then dress them every day. The other automatic trigger for eligibility is a situation where you might not have any physical issues, but you have a severe cognitive impairment, like Alzheimer's. The person may be able to physically do something, but requires a lot of supervision. So in either of these situations, either physical need or cognitive need could make you eligible for the care, for the benefit of the policy.
So, in addition, standby assistance is also a benefit trigger. So if you need somebody to be there while you perform activities of daily living in order to do so safely, that will also trigger the benefit in the policy.
Thank you, Steve. So the next real question is, and we hear this a lot, when is the right time to buy long-term care insurance? The fact is, the right time to purchase long-term care insurance is as soon as you're aware of the need and think it might be appropriate for you. Because each year that you wait, regardless of what age you are, the insurance company will charge you more over the life of the policy because you're older and at a higher risk of needing long-term care. For example, so there's an advantage to buying at age 45 to 50. There's an advantage to buying at age 40 versus 45. So, you know, to explain the advantage, let's say someone will pay premiums until they're at age 85. The 45-year-old will pay 40 years of premiums. The 50-year-old will pay 35 years of premium. The 50-year-old is going to pay 5 fewer years of premium payments, but they still are going to pay more in total premiums because their initial payment was higher than the 45-year-old. Bottom line is, the sooner you buy long-term care insurance, the less expensive it will be over the course of your life. There's another reason to make this decision sooner rather than later. Bigger concern than cost is health, because part of aging, you know, as many of us already experienced, we have an increase in health issues. You know, part of this process in getting long-term care insurance requires an insurance company to determine how healthy you are. So as a rule, and not unexpectedly, companies are looking to insure healthy people who do not already have an indication that they will imminently need long-term care insurance. That's not to say you have to be without any health conditions, but they're looking to issue policies to people who are not already or soon to be experiencing a long-term care event. So conditions like Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, and MS would make someone ineligible to be issued long-term care insurance. So there really are advantages to applying when you're younger, both in terms of being accepted and the lower premium you will pay for your insurance. So I'll pause with that. Steve, would you like to add anything before we turn over to Kara for any questions that the participants might have?
I'd just like to say that I know we're reaching a national audience here, and costs are particular to the state and the community in which you may reside, but major metropolitan area costs are in the neighborhood of $400 per day or $12,000 a month. The highest cost states are Alaska and Hawaii at $900 a day. Lowest cost would be a state like Montana, but there are very few caregivers and fewer people. Costs there range at about $150 on average per day. So the actual cost of an event could be higher or lower depending on where you live.
Thanks, Steve. So Kara, are there any questions from the participants? Why don't we open it to questions?
Yes, we do have a bunch of questions that are pouring in. So I will begin with the first. As a 40-year-old in good health, and it's now still unclear to me, and I'm speaking for the registrant here, is now too early to invest in long-term care insurance?
No, it is not too early. It is not too early because one of the prime problems in people trying to obtain long-term care insurance is insurability. That is, many times people as they age have the beginnings of a chronic situation or chronic conditions such as diabetes, being one of the most common. So the earlier you do it, the more protection you have, better off you're going to be. there is industry-wide a 26% declination rate, so over 25% of the people who apply can't get it.
Okay, great. Thank you, Steve. Another question, I guess this would be for you, Corky. In the presentation, there were several slides, and you were giving some numbers for costs. And we need to know, are these costs monthly or annually?
Those were annual costs.
Okay, great. Thank you. Another question, what are the tax advantages of long-term care insurance?
Premiums are tax deductible on the federal return on Schedule A when aggregated with other expenses not covered by insurance. If that exceeds 10% of your adjusted gross income, you get to deduct that cost. States, individual states, offer tax credits or deductions that vary by states. For example, New York will give a 20% tax credit to anybody who is paying a long-term care premium that resides in the state or works in the state. Other states have different credits, such as Virginia, 15%, so it varies. And there are some states like Connecticut that offer no tax incentive whatsoever. So that varies across the map. If you have a business can be a payer for long-term care insurance, and it is deductible above the line on your business return. So that's a distinct advantage to a business. Also, if a business sponsors an offering, there would be sex-neutral pricing versus sex-distinct pricing. Currently, sex-distinct pricing makes it a higher cost for women than it is for men. So there's another advantage there. All benefits, when they're paid, are tax-free, no matter who the payer may be.
Great. Thank you, Steve. Another question, what happens if you get insurance, for example, in New York State, and then you move out of state? Do the costs change, or are you locked into the New York State costs?
No, you are. The cost for services will change from where you go, but your insurance policy is a contract that remains on the books and will pay benefits in any state in which you reside.
Okay, great. Thank you. Another question, are there differences in the type of coverage options? So assuming that I purchase one in good health and then down the line get sick, are there certain illnesses that are not covered? Are there any hidden surprises to be aware of?
No, once you are insured, you are insured, and if your health deteriorates, you still remain insured at the same level and the same cost. One thing that should be noted here is premium expenses are not guaranteed by any company. And the reason for that is we do not have an extensive database of statistics as we do in other lines of insurance. For example, for life insurance, we have statistics that go back to the Civil War, and the So the government allows an insurance company, if it has a 60% or more deficit, that is their loss ratio, paying out more than they are receiving in premium, they can apply to the state commissioner of insurance for a rate increase. Some companies that have made some mistakes in pricing long-term care insurance have done that and have raised rates, and other companies have not. So they do have the right to do so. They can only with permission of the state commissioner, and many times the state commissioner will not simply rubber stamp a rate increase. We're seeing more and more of that. But it's important to know that the insurance company needs to have a viable way to finance this contract going forward. And that's why the HIPAA law, which governs long-term care insurance, allows an insurance company to do that. But in general, your premiums will remain the same unless you have a participating company, such as Northwestern is. They will pay dividends, which would reduce the cost.
Thank you so much, Steve. Another question for you. Can you give us a brief explanation as to what partnership plans are?
Sure. Partnerships refer to a program that was started by the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation that was financed by them. It refers to a partnership between the insured, the state, and the insurance company. It requires the insurance company to issue a policy. The insured buys at a minimum of $252 per day in benefit. It requires home health care. It will pay for either a 2 or 3 year benefit period. That is called a partnership policy. The advantage of a partnership policy is that if you have exhausted the benefits in that policy and you still need care, you can then apply to the state for Medicaid to pay for the additional cost that you may incur. And you will be able to conserve some or all of your assets. Now that sounds wonderful because you get the government to pick up the slack, but the one thing most people aren't aware of is that you still have to assign all of your income to qualify for Medicaid. Medicaid in every state requires that you assign all of your income in excess of $50 per month. All your Social Security, all your pension benefits, income from any source. So for many people, this is not a practical way to finance the cost of care, but for some, it's a valuable way because if, in fact, you do need care beyond those 3 years, you can conserve some or all of your assets, depending on the state that you're dealing with. Any Northwestern policy is considered to be a partnership policy in all states, except the original partnership states of New York, California, Indiana, and Connecticut. Okay.
Steve, thank you so much for that. And Corky, thank you as well. I believe that concludes today's presentation. As everyone knows, we will be sending out the slide deck of the presentation, so you can be sure that you have Stephen Corky's notes as well as their contact information if you have any other questions. But from Georgetown University today, I'm wishing everyone a great rest of the afternoon, and thank you again for joining.
Thank you, Kara.
Thank you.